And it was really nice being with you. It's the baptism of Jesus. That's what we're celebrating. That's why we have the white vestments. Because when I walked in and I thought, it's Epiphany, we'll have, oh no, we don't have green yet. We have the baptism of Jesus. And it's one of those church calendar years that, or calendar days, that is especially appropriate for baptisms. And in some congregations, not the one I usually go to because it's too big, too limited to those days that are assigned for baptisms. Well, a lot of churches, they only do baptisms on those certain days, which is nice. And so I was standing back there by the baptismal font during the time of the announcements and thinking, ooh, I want to go bless some water, put it in here, and then sprinkle it on everybody, because that's one of the most fun things you get to do. And in my mind, I saw Frank Griswold. Does anybody know that name?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. He was the presiding bishop, but before that, he was the bishop of Chicago, and he's the one who ordained me as a deacon and then a priest. And I remember being at the cathedral, I think it was probably for an Easter vigil. And he took such great pleasure in sprinkling everybody. So I'm sorry, I don't get to do that today.
We can arrange it.
Oh, quick.
I know when there's water.
And in fact, we go cut a branch of an evergreen. To use
one right behind you.
Oh, I could have some fun today.
This one's getting a little fragile.
Yeah, but it's black and white. But anyway, there just is so many things in these readings that grab me, anyway. Like the fact that Jesus was baptized by John. And when he came up out of the water, that's the way it talks about it. He came up out of the water. That's when heavens were torn open and the Holy Spirit descended upon him. Did it sing like a dove? Not in this one, I don't think. Oh, no. No dove. Yes, descending like a dove on him. And so, of course, you've probably seen people wearing a dove around their neck, and the dove is facing downward, and you know that that's the dove, the symbol for the dove descending on us as the Holy Spirit, not the dove with the branch in its mouth.
Olive oil.
Yeah, one and the same, but anyway, so I'm thinking, what happened to Jesus after he came up out of the water and saw this and heard God's voice? God's voice. Remember what happened after that?
Wilderness.
Yes. It sent him to the wilderness. And I have to think that it did that because it scared the bejeebers out of him. I mean, come on. Okay. So he knew who he was? Maybe. But he tried to ignore it. Have you ever had that experience? You know who you are or what you're supposed to do, but you go, I don't think that's exact. No, God, forget it. You might not think it's God giving you those impulses, but guess what? The psalm, the voice of the Lord is upon the waters, a powerful voice, breaks trees, makes Lebanon skip and a mountain just go crazy. Okay, if the voice of the Lord can do that, what is it doing to us? What is it doing to you? Okay, I give you a little insight into my own experience of being called to priesthood. The moment I heard the call, I immediately turned around and ran. And fought it for 6 months until I couldn't fight it anymore. And I thought of this cheer that the cheerleaders did at the University of Georgia basketball games, because that's where whack him upside the head. Whack him upside the head. Whack him upside the head. That probably wouldn't be a cheer today because it would be too violent. But I tell you what, when God whacks you upside the head, and that's what I felt like, you know it. So Jesus, I think, got a little whack upside the head. That Holy Spirit dove that descended on him was maybe not gentle. We always think of the Holy Spirit as being gentle. And of course we want that because we want comfort. And we do. We do get that. We need it. You know, the Holy Spirit, the Holy Comforter. You know? But the Holy Spirit also sends us out. God's voice causes us to pay attention and sometimes to run. Maybe we're running towards something. Maybe we're running away. But God understands that because Jesus understands that. Jesus knew that an encounter with the living God was a fearsome thing. A fearsome thing. An awesome thing. And so even though Jesus is God, Jesus is also us, is also humanity. Now, look at that last sentence in the gospel. And a voice came from heaven. You are my son, the beloved. With you, I am well pleased. I am well pleased. That's what God is saying to us. Not just this morning on the feast of the baptism of Jesus, but every day. Even when it might feel like a whop upside the head. Most of the time those whops come from our inner voice when we know that, I really wish I would have behaved a little differently. You know, just a little differently when I was sitting around with friends. I didn't need to say that, but did I say that? Oh, I know none of you have ever done that. You know, God talks to us with that still small voice, but the voice of the Lord makes the oak trees rise and strips the forest bare. You know, we get stripped bare by that still small voice of God. And when we come to our senses, we can thank God that we did. Because then we can make different choices. And there are a few people in this congregation who are not ancient. And so I speak to you, as well as we who are ancient, that it goes on all your life. It never stops. God always is speaking to us and showing us how to be more fully human. More fully human. I dropped in on a Sunday school class a while back that were, oh, I don't know, maybe they were 10 or 12 years old and they were talking about something and the voice of God, and the dove descending on Jesus, the voice saying, "You are my beloved."